Dad, I took this e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, d4, pawn takes.
Yes.
So I played bishop c4. He played bishop e7. Now I played knight takes pawn. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Next he played knight takes knight, queen takes, and he played d6.
Crunch.
So I play queen g7, and then he loses.
Yeah, real quick.
Yeah.
So you grab his rook, and then what happens?
Well, after I grab his rook, it's all downhill from then, because I just moved my knight up.
I remember back when I was three and a half, I kept on asking my daddy, could he teach me to play the game in which was that there was that board and those, and what were those funny things sticking out of that big box on the high shelf? We used to just play at home, and there was either a game where he would help me, or discussion where we would discuss the moves, or a game where he played his best and smashed me.
I learned to play chess in my 20s. Some people start younger.
When I was very young, my father showed me a chessboard. And I guess I liked it because the pieces taste good.
I'm hooked to it because I'm a very competitive person. I love sports. I love all sports. And I guess I'm good at chess. I guess that's why.
Actually, I like playing chess because it makes me feel good. Then it's developed the brain.
It teaches you how to sort of think about, like, you have to think about what are you planning to do. You can't just make one move and then make another move and then make another move. You have to sort of think of a plan, so you have to plan ahead.
Because it's nice. You can't break your legs or anything like that, like you could do in running or jumping, things like that.
One day while reading the LA Times, I came across an article about a 12-year-old chess wizard. Judit Polgár, a Hungarian girl, became the youngest person ever to gain the title of international master, which Bobby Fischer and Garry Kasparov did not achieve until they were 14. Men and women play for separate world titles in chess and have segregated ranking lists. In Romania, Judit refused to play for the girls' world title, so she competed in the boys' division and became the world under-12 boys' champion. Funny that a little newspaper article could have such an impact on me. Judit Polgár is in New York City to play in the New York Open, one of the most prestigious chess tournaments of its kind. As a side event, she's showing off her formidable chess skills in a simultaneous exhibition. 30 chess players are here to challenge this 12-year-old international master, so Judit is playing 30 people in 30 individual games simultaneously. At the last moment, I signed up to be one of Judit's opponents. After only 2.5 hours, Judit had beaten 25 of us. I knew I didn't stand a chance against Judit Polgár. I'm not in the same league as these other players, even the young ones. But there was that moment when she paused at my board. Had I stumped her? A draw? Hope springs eternal. The year was 1989. In the next 3 years, Judit Polgár would beat Bobby Fischer's record to become the youngest grandmaster in the history of chess. I wondered, was she a world champion in the making? Marion College is the site of the largest youth chess tournament of its kind ever held in the United States. I landed here with a sound man and a cameraman to record Judit Polgar and 170 other chess geniuses at the 1990 World Youth Chess Festival for Peace.
My name is Richard Peterson. I'm from Austin, Texas, and I have two children playing in the World Youth Chess Championships. David, who is 10, is playing in the boys' 10 and under section. Andrea, who is 7, is playing in the girls' 10 and under section. This has been quite an experience for them because essentially they're playing national champions every single round from around the world, and it's a tough time for them.
I'd say the most interesting thing from my point of view, as an American, you have a sense for chess in your own country. And the kids that are on our team are very, very talented, all of them. And several of them have been national champions and the highest rated for their ages in the United States. And you come here and you think you're going to knock them dead. And you arrive among these kids and you find out how fantastically strong players are from all around the world. And it's kind of daunting and at the same time exciting.
Fred Waitzkin knows about competition. His son Josh was the subject of his book, Searching for Bobby Fischer.
We just know about this tournament 2 weeks ago, and we fly 25 hours and came here. We still have a chance, good chance.
It's exciting. The world's top young chess players are gathered here in this gymnasium. 44 different countries sent their best and brightest to compete for 6 world championships, under 14, under 12, and under 10, with separate divisions for boys and girls. Separate, that is, with one exception, Judit Polgar, who's competing for the world under 14 boys title.
These kids are the best players from their countries for their age groups. And there are several here of international master strength, such as Judit Polgar of Hungary, or Emelin from the Soviet Union, very powerful player.
Judit is the current World Under 12 Boys Champion and the highest rated player here, which qualifies her to compete in the boys division.
It's very good that they're allowing her to play in the boys section because this comment isn't sexist, but it's true that the girls of the same age as the boys have not been as successful in that they don't have as high ratings as the boys do.
Well, I don't think just because they're boys they can be better than girls at things like chess. I mean, if you start the same age and you do the same amount of work, you're going to be the same. Not the boys are going to be better than you, even if you did the same work. Because there's lots of good girl players. There's some good boy players, too. But girls can be as good at chess as boys. Or if boys don't work as hard, then girls can be better.
Judit is the only girl playing in the boys' section, although Noroz Noor, a recent emigre from Bangladesh, now a U.S. player, thought there were 2 girls.
In the morning, I'm playing Laro, who is from France. At first, I thought he's a girl and he's playing in the boys' section. Then I know he's a boy because actually he looks like a girl. He got a long hair, then similar to girl.
Does it affect your game to play a female?
It affects my game. Sometimes it doesn't affect a lot of other people, but it affects my game. I mean, I'm a teenager and, you know, I like girls and everything, so I have that trouble a lot. I had the trouble in my game against Judy. And I also played a match in England against Kathy Forbes, who was the women's champion there. And I had trouble looking at the games. I've always had that trouble when I'm playing against women.
Men don't like it very much, especially when they play women player. They always play under a certain pressure. And they make mistakes they might not do playing a man. There shouldn't be any separation between tournaments, women tournaments, men tournaments. We should all play in one, especially the children, I think.
Unlike the NBA playoffs, no one gets eliminated in this Swiss system tournament. All players play all 11 rounds, paired with other players of like scores. Each player must make at least 50 moves in 2 hours. If the games aren't completed in the regulation 4 hours, they're adjourned and finished before the week-long tournament is over.
There are two types of chess players or more. One you can see all on his face, and one even if he loses everything, you don't see anything on his face, but in his heart is very much going on.
What kind of player are you?
I don't know, but I think more on the face. I don't know during the game, but when I lose a game, I'm very sad, and you can see it on my face when you meet me on the street. You don't need to ask me one, or you can see it.
You seem to be a good sport for your age. You seem to take winning and losing very well.
Is that supposed to be a question?
Yes. Do you think you do? Is it hard for you?
Well, sometimes I don't particularly take it well, because I think there was cheating going on, but that's usually in the football matches we have at school.
Now, chess, for me, for example, chess has taught me a lot of things in life. Now, one of the things which chess has taught me is how to win from a practically lost position. Now, this also can be applied to life. For example, in life, if you are victimized, if you are, you know, pulverized one way or another, and you feel you're simply hopeless, your life is meaningless. But it can teach you how to come back, fight back like a tiger, and eventually prevail.
A stunning move. If you go like this, they'll get even more confident. But if you just look like this and then make your next move, it makes them feel like, was that the right thing to do? Even though I usually have a hard time not doing that, but you should try not to be too excited over anything.
I think about weird things during a game. Sometimes I think about what my opponent is thinking and how I can think something and look at him in a way that makes him think something else. And everybody's trying to psych out their opponent in different ways. And you want to kill your opponent. You know, it's ridiculous.
Sometimes I sing to myself, like all the new songs, just at random. Sometimes I think about movies or TV shows. 2 games ago, not this one, the game before, I was thinking about this episode of Gilligan's Island where Gilligan was judging a beauty contest and he entered a gorilla. And it was just really stupid, but it's one of those things that stick in your mind. It's just like when you see a bad commercial and you have the jingle stuck in your head.
What goes on in my mind? Now, let's see. In the opening, it's just, let's see what he plays. Hope I get a good attacking position. But as we enter the middle game, sometimes I get surprised by moves and just a kind of alarm bell rings inside me saying, quick, check out that move. And then, usually, in about a second, it's okay, and the alarm bell stops ringing.
If we are losing, we must not cry, or we must not lose our temper and become tension. If we become tension, our brain will not work so properly than before. In chess, they don't cry. Garry Kasparov loses, he doesn't cry.
I don't want her to see if I'm mad or happy, because if I make a good move, I don't want to show her that I'm happy, because it might be throwing checkmate. She might not see it, but if I'm all happy, she'll look for it.
So show me the expression that you put on your face so she doesn't know what you're thinking. Now show me the expression if you make a good move. Show me the expression if you make a bad move.
We have to keep the same instruction so she doesn't know.
Here's Paul Gurens, the coach from Luxembourg. Not all countries were able to bring coaches.
Coaches, usually in this tournament, they help us prepare for our rounds by telling us what our opponents have played in the past and how we could play against them. And when we adjourn our games, which is after a certain amount of time and a certain amount of moves, we can stop and then go to our coaches and ask for advice about the game.
Right, you played this, and she may have played this, sealed this.
Adjournments are a new experience for these kids. They have 1 hour to analyze their positions with their coaches and come up with a winning or drawing line.
I was amazed that she, as she discussed this with the international masters on the U.S. coaching staff, she refuted several of their lines and came up with improvements on others. That I was very surprised she was able to do that.
And you can also think about playing this. That's a good point. Okay, maybe it's better not to play your queen here, because your queen is here right now, it's protecting a knight, and then this wouldn't be possible. So maybe in this position it is better to play your rook here first.
My coach is my brother.
She likes
it. It's not good because he's little, and that makes him a bad coach. Just because he's little doesn't mean he's good at teaching little kids, because usually, if he was bigger, like 21 or something like that, he wouldn't goof around, because, well, they're more in things like getting cars and things like that.
I'm
this
announcing
is my dad.
For...
He's a pretty good coach, but he shouldn't be a coach. He should be dad instead.
That's true too. It's very difficult. It's a very difficult relationship coaching your own children, because sometimes the line between being a parent and being a coach is very, very fine. You don't want to be too tough on your own kids. I mean, you love your kids. But at the same time, you want them to do the things that they need to do over the board. So I would almost always rather have someone else coaching my children than me.
Did you teach Noor how to play chess?
Yeah. He took a lesson from me, but now he is learning from John Collins. He's the teacher of Bobby Fischer, you know. And he produces about 15 grandmasters. He's one of the best teachers in the world.
He's got to take with a pawn to get a counterattack going. If he takes with a rook, it's too slow. If he takes with a pawn, you can take
this. Noor has the benefit of three coaches from the U.S. staff, including international master Nikolai Minev, author of the Endgame Encyclopedia, on the left, and grandmaster Paul Benko in the center.
This is that draw.
Yeah.
I think you draw in many ways. One is, I think, to play this.
Yeah, but we try to win, not to draw.
Ah, or to win is not possible.
Yeah. Some tricks, maybe. Okay.
You want to win.
Yeah, but draw, it's not.
This draw is easy.
I think we must take the draw.
Yeah, that was an insane situation. He was trying to prepare for his next game, and two of the world's best analysts were exchanging ideas, one saying one thing and the other saying another. And here he has 5 minutes before going to the board, trying to decide which one is the right one.
Not the same. Wait a minute. No, I cannot move that.
This is the position which is need to be analyzed.
One is telling another, and one is telling another, and I am not understand none of it because if both persons say at a time, I can understand it. So at that time, it's actually I'm not understand anything, and it's killing my time too. And making my head clumsy.
Take this, get the first game. The difference is when you double it,
and he goes away, they give you a press, and you push the pound, and then give
it
short.
But in this position...
If he stay, you take this pound, which is right.
But if you're in this position, if you take...
Go to take, I take with the rope.
Take, and he's lost.
Go to now.
And I take this.
Good.
Now, what's happening now? What are you? What's your game now going to be? Who are you playing, and what are your feelings?
I'm playing another person from on my U.S. team. And see, our coaches said that if the two U.S. people play, they're not going to prepare either player because it's not fair. So I just have to prepare on my own. And
who are you playing?
I'm playing a girl named Andrea Peterson.
Are you nervous?
Kind of.
Well, I'm 10 years old, and Andrea is only 7, so she's very, very good for her age. And she's like definitely the best 7-year-old I've ever seen, probably the best 8-year-old too, even though she's not 8. And she plays really well for a little kid like her, and I'm sure it must be really hard because like for her to take all the pressure because she's still just a little kid.
Well, when I was playing her, I tried to forget all about she was my teammate or my friend. And I thought about something that my brother told me. That sounds very stupid. But what he said was you're not playing another human being, you're playing the chessboard. That sounds stupid, doesn't it?
No.
I think it does, but I mean, it was funny.
Victoria's father told me he woke her up just before the game and doesn't believe in preparing her too much. Andrea's dad said they worked on a lot of Russian analysis.
Andrea and Victoria are the two highest-rated American girls. So they're going to be facing each other sooner or later. So they might as well be here this round. Andrea set up a very interesting trap for Victoria. Victoria fell in it. Now we're going to see if Victoria can crawl her way out.
The trap she played on me it seemed pretty complicated, and it was really long. So, see, what she did was she gave me a free pawn. So after I took the pawn, she started attacking me, locked in all the pieces that I hadn't developed, attacking my king, and I got a terrible position, and I never seen this trap before in all the games I've played this opening, and it was just so stunning.
Victoria is a little older, and her strength is in her ability to think through the position, understand the position. And she does not play very much chess, believe it or not, except for this week. And so she doesn't quite have the routine down. So once she gets out of the opening into the middle game where nothing is known, no advice is helpful, then she always does well. So it's a wild game. No, Andrea is attacking quite hard and Victoria is defending the best she can.
How did Andrea do?
She's winning right now.
How much?
Just up the exchange. But she has a knight in the middle of the board. That'll be all right.
What opening?
Marshall. She played the marshal.
What was it? I mean, how was it gone?
She played on the ninth move, she played the rook to e3 to block the pin on the queen.
Yeah?
So.
Right, the rook to e3 to block the pin on the queen?
Yeah.
Oh, and just took it, yeah.
Yeah, she just takes it.
So that was an easy marshal trap.
Yes.
She fell into that?
Yes. Well, it's hard to say.
Well, I mean, yeah, but if you play Ruy Lopez, you've got to know it.
Yes. Well, we'll see how it works out. Even with the advantage that Andrea has right now, I'll kind of be surprised if she wins this game, just because of the difference in experience. But Andrea has exceptional talent. That's really her only compensation.
If it's a pretty tough
it looks like it's going to be a tie, a draw. Then if it's that kind of position, I'll just say, well, I have as much chance of winning as she does. And if I flip out, I have no chance of winning. And if she's winning, I'll say to myself, well, like as my dad told me, in chess it's not over till it's over. You can be winning by a lot of pieces, but then you can make one mistake and the game's over.
The middle game, she was okay, and she didn't quit, and that's good. And if she would have quit, she wouldn't have went on and won the game.
How did you win?
I just started marching with my pawns, and I defended my king, and she resigned. The game lasted about 3.5 hours, but it seems like a really long time, like if you're standing out there and watching all the people inside play. But actually, when you're sitting there playing, you don't think about, oh no, 1 hour's gone by, 2 hours gone by, 3 hours gone by. You just think about the position, so it goes by fast. I'll probably take a rest and maybe play some tennis and play a little soccer because we bought a soccer ball, and eat dinner and go over maybe some more chess.
As soon as they finish here, they rush to the games room, so they need to get out all that pent-up energy.
It's good to see that these kids are jocks as well as brains. They don't just think, eat, sleep, dream, chess.
In fact, I had a dream last night about chess, but I don't really know how often I do dream about chess, because about 90% of my dreams I just don't know about, probably.
Right.
The dream was I was playing the same person I played in round 3. And we can never really get going. And we kept on putting up the original position up again. We kept on starting again.
Was that frustrating?
No, because it's a dream.
He loves meeting children from other nations, and he loves going into the games room and into Skittles room, and he loves the fact he can stay up past 8 o'clock, because 8 o'clock's his normal bedtime, and he's going to bed at 10:30 here. He's analysing and playing and doing all sorts of wonderful things with chess until 10:30 at night. He came over here fairly cocky, and it's just made him realise that there are so many children all over the world who are just as good, if not better, than he is. So it's been an eye-opener for him.
Now that the kids are on a break, maybe I can talk to more of them. I gave up on interviewing Judith. Her dad spoke little English and didn't promote the idea of free interviews with his famous daughter. So I thought I'd start with the former girl world champion, Diana Dakria from Russia. Language barrier notwithstanding.
Last year, you were the world champion. No English, right? Okay.
Do you speak Russian?
No, I speak Spanish. Do you speak Spanish?
Bueno. Spanish did come in handy.
Inmediatamente. Ya el control de tiempo. Comprar tus jugadas, hablo rápido.
Al momento que ha hecho time control.
They don't speak the same language.
No, that's so.
They need someone to.
No translation.
I wasn't the only one struggling to communicate.
Just chop.
Mesh the best.
This is right. You leave the correct position here.
Okay. Now. Communicate with me.
No. Don't turn around. Oh, yeah, this should be the same way.
That's the amazing thing about chess. They sit across the board from perfect strangers, and within 2 or 3 hours, they can tell you more about these children than probably some of their friends. They can tell you whether the child's emotional, they can tell you whether he's controlled, they can tell you whether he hates to win, they can tell you whether he's fazed by losing. It's just an amazing game. It speaks a universal language.
chess may be a universal language, but with the silence all around us, I couldn't tell you who was winning or losing.
You can see a boy sitting there almost 8 hours, and the expression, the face, facial expression is very calm. Yeah, the coolness. You cannot continue if you don't have that quality.
He's not cool. He's Italian. How can he be cool? He had 2 games earlier in the tournament where he got into time trouble. He was like a raving lunatic. I'm sure the opponent had, the opponent knew he'd won because Charles just went berserk.
Okay, I'm a father. I can see my son is losing. I can take a glass of water to him and tell him, this is your move, boy. In the same time, I can stand and suffer and give it a meaning that he will go through this and he will learn from it. He loses or he wins. Nobody can win all the time, you see. It's not possible.
Well, some parents probably are just a bit fussy over what goes on. Like, if their child's been paired black twice in a row. Or there's a controversial decision.
Every game that your children play is a little bit like waiting to give birth, where a mother or father isn't really a participant in the process, but it's as if maybe your child is giving birth for the first time, and you're a nervous wreck, and you hope for the best, but if it doesn't turn out that way, it's your loss too.
My girl defeated one of the most, one of the top chess playing nations of the world, East Germany. We missed out the West, but we made sure the East got in the bag nicely. And for this today, I'm over the moon, I would say.
Sometimes they can be very strange if you don't do well. And I think that's all I can say about parents.
I feel that most parents are very supportive of their kids. They're sacrificing a lot. Chess is an expensive hobby. They're sacrificing a lot just to have their kids play chess.
Last enough, and I have is, again, the skills room is finally set up. It's right across from where we're eating in the Commons building. We've got about 30-some sets set up for you. You can go in there. Please do not take any.
The organization of the tournament was very good. The only thing which was very, very bad was 2 rounds in 1 day. So this was incredible because it was days when I played 10 hours chess with a break, 1 hour to eat.
Tied up and not being able to move. Just you're kind of stuck at the chessboard. So after you've played a move after a long thing, I usually go for a walk, see what the other games are like.
You want to see something good? This is Bobby Fischer's autograph. I can tell you the story behind this. Back in 1962 or 63, Fischer was touring the United States and he was out of money. So he had some of his books with him and he had to make his hotel payment. So he sold some of his books for like 10 or 15 bucks and autographed them. And that's how we got a hold of this. And selling for $150.
Yes. Among the books written about chess Art prodigies, Fischer, you'll find the names Judit Polgar and Josh Waitzkin.
Let Josh move the pieces.
Oh, this isn't so hard. Here, I'll play h5 immediately.
Okay, fine.
Just so you know, maybe something.
Don't fool around. Just play the moves.
He takes. Take.
King g3.
I was 6 years old when I was walking through where we live in New York City. There's a place called Washington Square Park where they play chess, and I was walking through and I thought the pieces looked interesting. I thought they were lined up when they were set up. I liked that, and I asked my dad to show me how to play, and he said no. I said yes, no. And after a while, he wouldn't do it. And so I asked my friends, they did. And then when he saw that I really meant it, he started playing with me. I kept on playing. When I was 7 or 8, I was playing in the park. And my teacher, who brought me pretty much all the way out, it was Bruce Pandolfini, he found me there. And he asked my dad if I could study with him. And I did, and I kept on working until I was about, I think I was 10 when I stopped working with him. But I've always been working with him on and off.
There's only 2 checks.
Check. Where's the second?
Check here. And queen h7 is like king.
King h6 again. That's the traditional hiding place in this line.
I think queen f7. Maybe.
After listening to all this analysis, I wondered, does chess make kids smart?
Oh, definitely. It develops logical thinking, and it also helps in that if you start playing chess, then you calculate better, as in math, and you come to many more in-depth conclusions in your schoolwork.
Here's Morgan's chess teacher, Svetozar Jovanovich, who led New York City's Dalton School to more than its share of national championships.
I got the famous phone call one day from Mr. Jovanovich. My son was all of 5 years old and change. He was a kindergartner at the Dalton School. And early on in the school year, I got a call from it went something like this. The call came through. Mr. Newman, yes, Jovanovich here. Who? Mr. Jovanovich. I'm the chess coach at the Dalton School. Yes, okay. I've spent about 15 minutes today with your son working on chess. Your son is going to be the national kindergarten champion. Now we will work out the details.
Well, in kindergarten age, it takes a couple months before I'm sure that has a talent, because talent what consists, I consider not only talent, pure chess, and also knowledge what they have, but what is the most important, right character. To have ability, what the German call Sitzfleisch, to think, desire to win the game. Then not to fall apart when you lose, to be good loser and a good winner and everything. That is what the right character, not to give up.
What do you think of Judith Polgar?
She's awesome.
I think she's a good chess player.
She's a good player, let's just say that.
Pienso que ella es una... un genio y pienso que yo también lo voy a hacer.
She's an attacking player, actually. Girls is very defensive players, and she's an attacking player.
She attacked me. I played 2 times with her, 2 years ago and now. Both times with black, unfortunately. She began as quick as possible the attack. And it was very hard for me to defend, and I needed a lot of time. But then later, I think she made a mistake. I'm sure she made a mistake. And so from the attack in the game 2 years ago, I've got in a winning position. But I had about 3 minutes for 25 moves, and I accepted draw. I thought it's impossible for me to make so quick the moves. And 2 days ago, it was also a better end game for me, but it wasn't enough to win.
Judith, the highest rated player at the tournament, wasn't winning every game. She had draws with Gabriel Schwartzman from Romania, Ronen Harzvai from Israel, Vasily Emelin from Russia, and Josh Waitzkin from the USA.
What I was thinking about when I was playing her is, can I wasn't thinking as much winning as drawing. I wanted to draw the game, and I would have been very happy. A couple years ago, I played her in the last round of the World Championship, and I drew, and I was happy about that. But she's gotten much, much stronger since then. The emotion generally when you're playing a much stronger player is, I hope I draw, but I don't think I will. Or I hope I win, and I don't think I will. It's just more hopeful than it is realistic, I guess.
In a recent interview, Judith was asked what kinds of thoughts run through her head during a game. She said, "It is very complicated because, first of all, you cannot think only about one thing for 6 hours. I mean, it's really difficult. But of course, you must try to concentrate as much as possible. You have to find the critical points at the crucial moments. But sometimes you don't know what your opponent is going to play, so why wear yourself out? I go for a walk. I think of other positions. Maybe I will get some ideas from the other games. What damages your opponents most is when you destroy their preparation. Even if it's not the best move, it can be stronger at times when it bothers your opponent. An unexpected move determines the outcome of a match between two Americans, David Peterson and Naroz Nour, for the boys under 10 world title.
Well, at first he played an irregular move, a kind of move that wasn't exactly... Well, it wasn't anything I'd ever seen before. So what I did was I could have just gotten a better position by just making a simple developing move. So instead I decided to go for a cheap queen win. So I played this move, which obviously wasn't the best. I mean, it's kind of scary. You just look in this position and you're that much down.
Well, that's a very hard thing for us when an American plays an American. That the championship game was decided by an American having to beat an American. On the one hand, you want to celebrate, but what are we celebrating? The loss of another American. Very difficult thing for us. So I have to partition my thought, catch one kid on the side and catch the other kid and change my expression.
Grandmaster Arnold Denker was very impressed with Noor's performance.
Well, the move that he made in the opening, I'm telling you, wasn't good. But it was interesting and original. And that's why he put the other fellow to thinking. The guy thought for about 30 minutes right after that move. But he's a very good original player. This is rare to have an original talent. As many of them, you know, they go by the book, by rote, memory. Who's the original?
Afterwards, I mean, what's the actual game score back, okay?
Nur played an outstanding game.
How about my game?
Oh, yeah, how about your game? No, Nur played an outstanding game. He played a move that was not in any book. It was not necessarily a good move, but it was one that took David by surprise, and we were well booked for this game. Andrea's game was tactically wonderful. She did a fantastic, yes, she agrees with me. She did a fantastic job. And for being seven and having been ahead in every single game except one, she has a nice future in the next couple of years.
But so does David.
Oh, David? Absolutely. Well, there's no question about that.
Well, I'm kind of fading out. My sister's kind of fading in my place.
Now you're just both coming on strong.
Okay, this is Mario Moncayo from Ecuador. And we were playing, and I hung a piece on move 8. And then what happened was I got so upset that I just threw all my pieces at him. Not literally. I moved all my pieces towards his king, and I managed to get lucky because he didn't take my rook, and then I mated him. It was a very pitiful game on both sides. It deserved to be a draw.
¿Cómo es como jugador él?
Como jugador está correcto porque se merece, porque juega muy bien el ajedrez, y yo deseo que triunfe muy pronto.
He's saying that you really do deserve to win because you play very well.
No, I played horribly. This is the worst game of the tournament. The only other worst thing was when I hung mate against the Romanian.
By the way, Judith Polgar is now winning the tournament 14 after a...
After a rather shaky start.
Well, it was not super shaky, as a steady start. It was all but...
Yeah. But shaky, yeah. Because she's 2-5-4-0.
Yeah, but she didn't just come crashing everybody. She just got her draws at the start and was not coming through.
Yeah.
Judith has caught up from what Joseph called her shaky start. Despite four draws, she hasn't lost a game and is now tied for first place with the Russian player Vasily Emelin, who also hasn't lost a game. Judith wins her last game. Vasily makes a fatal mistake and draws. Judith becomes the 1990 Boys Under 14 World Champion.
We're organizing a blitz tournament.
Fred Waitzkin wants to hold an impromptu speed tournament out on the lawn. The games will be 5-minute blitz, but only if he can find 100 clocks.
But can we use the chess clocks?
Jack be nimble, Jane be quick. Make that move while your clock goes tick. In blitz, if your time runs out, you lose.
It didn't go nearly as well as we hoped. David, of course, had a very disappointing tournament. I've given Andrea and David both the opportunity to quit. David wouldn't hear of quitting. He loves the game, he wants to go on. Andrea says she wants to right now.
I'd rather be playing with my friends.
Did this tournament make you feel like quitting, or did you feel like quitting before?
I felt like quitting before.
Did you?
Yeah.
Well, she went through this these last 6 weeks for me. There's no question about that, because she qualified. And I said, well, Andrea, this is an opportunity that you shouldn't miss. And if you want to quit afterwards, that's your option. So if we're at that point, I'll be sad for it because she's an exceptional talent. But it's her life. It's her option.
So you kind of wanted to quit before the tournament, but you went ahead and did it anyway? And you did very well.
Next year I could win it, but I'm not even going to play in it.
Do you make that? No?
No, I'm
Oh boy. She killed me. I don't know what to say.
Judith has moved on to play the Russian Vasily Emelin at blitz, and once again they are tied. The crowd strains to get a glimpse of these two great players slamming their clocks in a battle of speed. Judith prevails. She wins the Blitz tournament and the boys under 14 world title just in time. The next day is her 14th birthday. Thank you. So do you think it's possible for a woman to become world champion?
Oh, I'm sure. As a matter of fact, my husband Arnold Denkett thinks that the Polgar girl may someday be champion if things go the way they should.
А вы не верите, что будет жена чемпион мира? Нет, мы
тоже не имеем. It's absolutely impossible, I'm sure. Absolutely impossible.
I think it's possible. Who knows what happens in a few years? You can't predict the future.
I think that easily a woman could be world champion. Easily.
What is your ambition in chess?
To become the world champion.
Twenty years have gone by since the World Youth Chess Championship in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, and I'm still intrigued with these chess kids, which begs the question, where are they now? I found Evelyn Moncayo on the web. She's an international master and runs her own chess academy. Abhijit Kunte is one of India's strongest grandmasters. And Vijayalakshmi Subbaraman became India's first woman grandmaster. I had no luck finding David or Andrea Peterson. They both seem to have disappeared from the chess world after high school. But what about Judit Polgár? I've landed at the Budapest Airport in Hungary. 1 year and 4 months after winning the boys' title at Fond du Lac, Judit became the youngest grandmaster in history, beating Bobby Fischer's record at the time. Today, the only woman on FIDE's top 100 players list, Judit has been ranked as high as 8th and remains the strongest female player of all time.
It was a strange experience because actually that was the only time, I think, when I was staying in a house, for example, with other kids in a tournament. My purpose to go there was to win. And by rating, I was also clearly higher than the others. But it was also not a very nice feeling that you go there that you have to win, because you're clearly better and second place is already a huge disappointment.
When I think about Fond du Lac, I had a really great time. I'm surprised at myself. I seemed so carefree.
This isn't fair.
I could tell I was very caught up in the issues of being a 13, 14-year-old boy.
It affects my game. Sometimes it doesn't affect a lot of other people, but it affects my game. I mean, I'm a teenager, and, you know, I like girls and everything, so I have that trouble a lot.
17 years later, the same guy. What can I say?
When I watch the film, I think, gosh, this looks like so much fun, and I look like I was just having the time of my life. And the memory that I actually have is more one of some tension and some pressure and maybe not being able to handle that sort of mental intensity with quite as much aplomb as I appear to in the film.
Okay, but you see the ideas, right, in that version?
Well, you want to
ask. Okay, let's start again.
What
was your move?
Yeah, but...
And at some point I piped up with some sort of objection to the line that they were proposing.
And you can also think about playing this.
If I go there, she might play there.
That's a good point. Okay, maybe it's better not to play your queen here, because your queen is here right now, it's protecting the knight, and then this wouldn't be possible.
They both sort of went, oh yeah. Never mind that one then.
Actually, I like playing chess because it makes feel good, then it's developed the brain.
It's a great experience to win, and you know, it was the first time I was representing USA. Previously, I had represented Bangladesh, so that was also very much of a shift. I didn't understand the significance of it at that point in time. But, you know, when everybody was congratulating me or, you know, it was like, oh, okay, big deal. It's like, honestly, at that point in my life, I was a very shy individual. So I was like, okay, why? It's just, you know, just another tournament.
But he's a very good original player. This is rare to have an original talent.
There are two types of chess players or more. One you can see all on his face, and one even if he loses everything, you don't see anything on his face, but in his heart is very much going on. When I lose a game, I'm very sad, and you can see it.
I think playing a little bit of poker has improved my ability to keep a game face on a little bit. And I remember my dad, you know, being able to watch from afar and pretty much know whether I was winning or losing or how upset I was.
I remember that I started off the tournament very well with four wins in my first four games. And then I played Noroz Nur in the fifth round. And I remember, and I got kind of a winning position very early on, but then I kind of mucked it up. And then I kind of went on to lose the game, which I was kind of quite upset about at the time. I can feel the poignancy I felt then, but I can't feel any real regrets.
Sometimes I get surprised by moves and just a kind of alarm bell rings inside me saying, quick, check out that move.
When you look back and see yourself as a nine-year-old, just being kind of the ingenuous in the way nine-year-olds are, you know, it is embarrassing, but yeah, I mean, I can see it's me. It's the same person. I would walk around, and I remember I'd play a lot of games standing. But that was kind of, I just had a lot of energy, and it was just, I didn't want to sit down because I just preferred standing up. That there were people from so many different countries, that was different, and that was exotic. There were lots of languages. I mean, I thought I was very kind of impressed by the fact I had a little flag. But by my board, that felt sort of nice.
Of course, Fond du Lac was exciting because after spending as much time playing for Romania, I remember we cutting out basically the communist emblem of the flag. They didn't have the new flags yet.
Chess was always a really cosmopolitan experience for me. From a young age, I never felt that it was bizarre meeting people from so many different countries and hearing so many different languages about me and being immersed in all these different cultures.
Yo deseo que triunfe muy pronto.
When we saw the players in the rest of the world and the great talents, even the mediocre talents in so many of these countries were at our level or far beyond our level, it was very humbling. I played the longest game of my life in that tournament with the champion of Mexico. We played a game that spanned 3 days and it elapsed 24 hours. So it was an extraordinarily grueling tournament, sleeping very little. So it was like fighting the Iliad. And it ended ultimately in a stalemate in true Grecian terms.
I think for most of the American participants, it was a shock somewhat. Everywhere else seemed to have a chess culture. This country didn't.
These kids are the best players from their countries for their age groups. And there are several here of international master strength, such as Judith Polgar of Hungary.
Nowadays, age of 14, you have to be a grandmaster already to reach potentially to be in world champion, let's say, or even to be in the top five. And there are many young kids, Russian, Ukrainian, who are there.
Playing Judith was always exciting. Obviously, at the time, she was the best player in the you know, in the world in our age group. She certainly was a phenomenon. She was a girl, you know, it was great because you'd actually you tried to play your best, obviously, against her. But there was a definite intimidation factor.
But there were some good players. I had an adjourned game with Josh. I remember Leko was there, he was playing on under 10. So it was kind of funny looking at it from now that he was 10 and looking at me and admiring me, and you know, now he's also on the top.
Fond du Lac happened in 1990 when I was 13 years old, and a couple years later, the film Searching for Bobby Fischer came out.
The movie version of Searching for Bobby Fischer is largely based upon the last chapter of Fred Waitzkin's book.
When I wrote the book, I hoped things would change. I hoped that chess would improve in the United States in the sense that a talented player would be able to project himself towards making a living at the game, and I don't think that's happened.
I kid my dad all the time that he taught me the wrong game. You know, had I become as good at golf as I did at chess, I would be, you know, set financially for the rest of my life and be enjoying it, or many other sports where, of course, the financial reward is much higher than in chess. So that part of it kind of, you know, stinks a little bit.
I was talking to the guy at my paper who writes the chess column. He told me I could find Bruce Pandolfini here. I'm looking for a teacher for my son.
I don't teach anymore.
I think when he had first seen the script, he had imagined this character out of Samuel Beckett, Malone, Malloy, one of those guys. Then he met this fellow from Brooklyn, and he made the best of it. Let's put it that way. I think he did a pretty good job.
Where can I go? Come on, John.
Young Fischer.
Come after me. Come after me.
The most important coach in my young life was Bruce Pandolfini. He was the guy who found me in Washington Square Park when I was 7 years old playing against the guys.
Nothing I can do now.
I was walking through Washington Square Park. I saw this charming little boy playing chess at a table. And I began to watch him, and he was doing some things that suggested to me that he might have a flair for this game.
Bruce was my coach from when I was 7 until I was 11 years old. And he was, you know, the guy who really inspired my foundation in chess and gave me my love for the game and gave me my love for the process. And that was the most important thing, having a relationship with chess, which was about loving the everyday study of the game. You know, Bruce had a wonderful, empathic, beautiful way, and his mode of teaching chess to a child, which I've come to believe is the best way to teach a child, is to teach from the end game first, teaching these principles in isolation.
Mate is 4 moves from the position in front of you. Don't move until you figure it out in your head.
Well, when the movie first came out, suddenly I was besieged by a new flock of potential students, which I enjoyed very much. And I think many of the parents expected me to exhibit bizarre behavior, you know, to yell at their youngsters and to demand incredible things over the chessboard.
Here, I'll make it easier for you.
I don't know, one of the things I'm most proud of in my life, and I don't even really play chess that much anymore, was the time when Bruce made me play an entire game in my head. And that was an incredible experience, and he just kept pushing me. It was the kind of thing where I was like, my head hurts, I can't do this anymore. But he made me keep going, and I played an entire chess game in my head, and certainly never accessed that many brain molecules since.
When they translated Searching for Bobby Fischer to the screen, I was also translated as Josh's de facto best friend and sidekick.
Morgan.
If you have a problem, you don't have to discuss it with your opponent.
Well, that was very interesting to see myself portrayed by an actor on screen, and also to see my father.
Okay, that's not bad, but that's not right. Okay. That's not what
my father is portrayed as, the consummate Little League father, the kind of overbearing, obsessive chess father, which really wasn't the case in reality. I have a very good relationship with my father, and I never felt any kind of apprehensions or anxieties around his involvement in my chess playing. As for me, I think it just missed out on all my fine nuances as a person.
Josh, where have you been? Fishing.
Certainly we are used, I can see now, as a screenwriter to be a kind of counterpoint for dramatic effect. So I really can't complain too much because, you know, there wasn't too much to my character to psychoanalyze or anything along those lines.
I'm offering you a draw. Draw, you've got to be kidding.
That was always a problem whenever you showed abilities. And of course this, you know, affected Josh very unfairly and others. To be compared to Bobby Fischer.
The movie really threw a tremendous spotlight onto my life. You know, I lost my first national championship, which was the best thing that ever happened to me. I was a late 7, early 8. I had been beating everybody in the scholastic chess world, and the final round I was playing against my friend later on, David Arnett, and I lost. I got killed. I didn't think anyone could beat me, and he destroyed me. And I went into a crisis.
If I win, everybody would say, well, of course he won. He's a top-ranked player. But if I lose...
You won't lose, Josh.
You know, I was just winning and winning and winning, and everyone told me I was such a winner. And then you lose, and if you win and win and win, people tell you that you win because you're a winner, then when you lose, it must mean that you're a loser. And as a kid, it's, you know, that reality is a hard thing to navigate, and I had to take on my relationship with chess. I had to kind of figure out what my relationship with chess was. For the months and the year that followed that loss, you know, my relationship with the game really changed. Because I developed a relationship to the game which was about a love and about the process. And it wasn't so much about being the champion or winning, but it was about really penetrating into the heart of the art.
The movie ends with Josh and myself walking off into the sunset.
You want to know a secret?
I'd like to think of myself as Gary Cooper, but I don't think I'm the Gary Cooper there.
I'm going to tell you a secret. You're a much stronger player than I was at your age. Thanks.
And so some of these youngsters who took off very nicely had trouble living up to that initial expectation.
I guess some people might find the pressure so great. Oh, I'm a prodigy. Now I have to win every tournament. I have to win every game. I have to, you know, really get in there and become national champion, become an international grandmaster. And that psychological pressure might be a deterrent.
I did really feel the extent to which I was now part of this very high pressure world when I took part in that tournament. I got a lot of pleasure out of just engaging with the game on this level that was just completely unselfconscious. And I think as I progressed as a player, I became more conscious of my performance. And I did struggle with this tension between the original reason that I was drawn to play chess, which was just purely for fun, and at the same time feeling like I had suddenly become caught up in this very intense, very high-pressure environment.
I think you draw in many ways. One is, I think, to play this.
Yeah, but we try to win, not to draw.
Or to win is not possible.
The game was adjourned, so had a little break, and the grandmaster was analyzing the best way for me to move forward and giving me advice. It's like, oh, going the safe route and taking the draw. That didn't appeal to me, you know. I wanted to go for the win.
If you stay, you take this pawn. What you say?
But if you're in this position, if you take.
What to take? I take with the rook.
And he's lost.
Now, see. Good.
The grandmasters themselves, they were talking and, you know, arguing amongst each other as if it was their game. And, you know, to me it was amusing because it's like, okay, most of the stuff was over my head. It's like, okay, you know, they're thinking 15 moves deep, analyzing whatever. And, of course, I wasn't getting it. It's like, okay, just give me the next 3 moves.
You know, it's a very kind of bizarre experience being at the top of a field when you're so young. When you're at the top of your sport, everyone knows who you are and everyone's gunning for you. And you have really nowhere to go but to maintain your position. And I think it makes things kind of stressful and difficult. And I wasn't always appreciative of how much fun chess can be. Searching for Bobby Fischer, everyone's moving instantly. Of course, it's completely unrealistic. Most of the time you're just sitting, staring at the board, staring at your opponent, you know, your mind wandering off to wherever it goes.
Gilligan's Island.
Yeah, to Gilligan's Island in my case.
You're the strongest woman player in the world, right?
Yeah, well, for next year it's going to be 20 years. I believe women can be as good as men. We started when we were very young, playing adult and most of the time with men. So by age of 7, 8, 9, it was the most natural thing to play against them. And the strange thing was if we play against women or kids. Basically, that's what I was fighting all my life. And then later on, of course, I had to prove it much more in results and in games, as let's say if I would be a boy. But once I broke in, they accepted me, like middle of 90s, I was accepted by my colleagues that they were not looking at me a girl or woman or long hair or whatever, they were taking me seriously as a chess player.
I kept playing competitively for many years. When I was 17, I became a grandmaster. At that time, I was the youngest grandmaster in the world, not in the history, but just at that time, I happened to be the youngest because Judith was actually three months older, I think, to the day. The grandmaster title is the highest title that you can achieve in chess. Some people compare it to a PhD. You know, it's a lot of work to get there, and you feel really good once you get that title, particularly since you can never lose it. I won the U.S. Open in 96, so I was 20 years old at the time, and I think I was the second youngest winner of the U.S. Open at the time in the history after Bobby Fischer. When I graduated college and went to work, that's when chess definitely suffered. I mean, it's a tough game to play competitively, professionally, at a grandmaster level while also working. Right out of college, I went to work for Burst Systems in a management consulting role and worked my way up, and I'm now the CEO of the company. We're a small software company. There's about 40 of us, but it's a lot of fun, and I've enjoyed it.
I was oftentimes in the top five players and the second in the country, but to really win the national championship as an individual was a great personal accomplishment. In a lot of ways, at that point was when I felt ready to leave chess, because I felt that I had attained the mark that I set out for. I had met a filmmaker named Esther Bell at a party, and she was looking to produce her second feature film. And I was able to help her arrange financing and for her picture, and that's what started me on my company, Merlion Entertainment. But we're about to finish our third feature film. In the course of that, I've been very fortunate to become an adjunct professor of film and journalism and television at St. John's University.
So string theorist, huh?
Yes, string theory, particle physics. Cosmology, yeah, those kind of subjects.
In particular, the gravitino mass is given by the Planck scale divided by the volume. So if you then work out what that is, so then the gravitino mass would be Planck scale over the volume, which is around 1 TeV.
There's this extraordinarily beautiful structure that you encounter with theoretical physics. It's extremely deep, it's conceptually extremely profound. Physics is fun, and it's a beautiful subject, and it's just, you know, it's fun to tell people about this beautiful subject. Chess, the game's over in 4 hours. You know, the problems you encounter in the game, you think about the problem for like 20 minutes, you decide what move you make, you know, you try and win. Physics, you know, the problems of physics might take 20 years to solve. And they need the efforts of hundreds of people. So then you think the sort of idea that takes 20 years to crack compared to the sort of idea that takes 20 minutes to crack. Yeah, you can see which one is more satisfying.
Currently, I'm going for my master's in nutrition and dietetics. Chess was my mental love, mental recreation, that helped me shape my mind. Now, the nutrition that I'm learning is helping me shape my body, and hopefully one day, when I become registered, I can help other people as well.
Let Josh move the pieces.
This isn't so hard. Here, I'll play h5 immediately.
Okay, fine.
Just so, maybe something...
Don't fool around, just play the moves.
With Searching for Bobby Fischer, Josh really became the most famous chess player in the country, even more famous than our top players. But really remarkably, in my mind, Josh has had much greater success in martial arts than he ever did in chess. He's been able to, as a martial artist, become a world champion, truly a world champion.
Towards the end of my chess career, I started getting very involved in East Asian philosophy and meditation, and I got into Tai Chi. And when I was 21, 22 years old, I started to transition away from chess and into the martial arts. I was very drawn to the meditative side of Tai Chi, to the philosophical side of Tai Chi. But then when I started getting into push hands, which is the martial embodiment of Tai Chi, all of my chess principles just simply crossed over. And I started having these amazing breakthroughs in chess that immediately launched my martial arts life to another level and back and forth. Tai Chi experiences would fuel my chess life in a wild way. One time I was giving a 40-board simultaneous exhibition, chess exhibition, where you walk around in a circle or a square playing against 40 people at the same time. And I realized about an hour and a half in that I wasn't playing chess at all. I was doing Tai Chi, I was doing push hands. I wasn't thinking in the language of chess. I wasn't thinking about numbers, I wasn't thinking about chess moves, but I was feeling flow, feeling space left behind, riding the wave of the game, almost feeling the energy of the game like I would be doing if I was doing the martial arts. And so these two arts became completely interwoven to me. It wasn't like they existed independently, they were the same. And so that learning experience inspired me to start putting together the ideas which became my book. I think that where my real passion lies is in learning and connecting different pursuits. And so you could say if someone's going to write a book like that, The Art of Learning, they must think that they have the answers. I don't really think that I have the answers. I think that I'm looking for better and better questions. You know, I'm working on these things.
Pretty much the same things have been going on. I've been teaching chess in schools, privately, writing my chess books as poorly as I do, having fun.
I did a bachelor's degree in computer science at Harvard, and now I'm working on my PhD under the joint supervision of a professor at the University of Michigan and a professor at University of Southern California. I work on the problem of machine translation, which involves training computers to be able to translate automatically from one language to another, for example, from Chinese to English or Arabic to English, something like that. Processing language is something that, while it's very easy for humans to do, is rather difficult for computers because of the ambiguity that's represented in language.
Well, I'm still on. I'm still on, and I came back because I was on the chess field, mostly on the top 10 in the world until 2004, when my first child was born, Oliver. And during the pregnancy and when I gave birth, it was more or less a year of break from chess tournaments. Then I came back with a good result in Holland. And then in 2006, my second child was born, Hannah. And now I'm back again after her. Actually, she was 6 weeks old when I had my first competition. But it was a blitz event with Kasparov, Korchnoi and Karpov. I just couldn't resist accepting it. It was a one-day blitz event, so...
With Kasparov and Karpov?
Yeah.
You're kidding!
Well, okay, they are not so much on the top already. I'm basically Kasparov withdrew, but okay, they are still excellent players, so I was like breastfeeding in breaks.
I can't shake the love of it. It was such an integral part of my life. If I could, I would make it my life, because it had engaged me. The fact that even that, you know, I am not completely in it, you know, that makes me sometimes feel that there's a part missing. But because, you know, I have been able to move away, that has allowed me to do other things.
It teaches you to think that, you know, you get something out of thinking, you know, there's a reward for thinking.
I don't know if it's brain waves or whatever the case may be, but there's a state of mind that you get into that allows you to be your best. The skills that you acquire as a chess player, the ability to be patient, to be meditative, to be contemplative.
And of course, one thing that chess teaches you is that we all lose. And how you cope with losing determines whether or not you will be successful.
Yes, chess is a challenge, but that's part of the enjoyment. I mean, life is a challenge, right? Somebody, a youngster facing challenge and being able to grasp that challenge and overcome that challenge, guess what? Few years when they have to face life's challenge, they'll be better able to handle those challenges because they've been exposed to it in a game.
I just do think there's something very humbling about anything, I guess intellectual or physical, but certainly intellectual, that you know that you were better at it at 10 than you are at 27. We'll be right back.
team game. Not on this game. Kiss pieces.